Okay, so let's start the lectures. So today we'll start with, we'll continue with the lecture on special theory of relativity. So we have been talking about relativistic kinematics, derivation of the energy momentum relationship in relativity, special theory of relativity, and then we talked about the group. The Lorentz group, the SO331, we introduced the Lorentz group, and then finally we were looking at aspects of light cones. So just to recap, we were looking at light cones. So light cone is nothing but an xy plane. So we just take the relationship ds square, which is essentially minus c square t square minus dx bar square. So we set it to 0, say, for example, so that's how the light travels. And in x and t plane, we have, this is x and t plane. So at x is equal to 0, t 0 is equal to 0, we have the origin. And when t is equal to 0, we can call it as the present. And when t goes greater than 0, that is called the future light cone. And when t is less than 0, then it's called the past light cone, essentially, which is the past light cone. So we can divide various events depending upon what are the length scales they are traveling, so line elements which they are satisfying. The light always travels along the boundaries of this light cone, where because it is ds square is equal to 0, it travels always with speed of light, and then it goes around these lines. This region on the right hand side, this region where ds square is greater than 0, that means it's like space, like when the space part of the metric metric will is more than the time part, dx square is greater than 0. In this case, what's happening is that these events are separated by distances which cannot be covered by light. So these are sort of occausal. These are occausal distances, whereas these distances, the colored regions, are time-like, in which the time part is larger than the spatial part. So which could be covered within the particles which are traveling even with speeds less than speed of light. So this is what we covered. Now, In addition to ds square is the metric line element, there is also, you can also draw a similar light cone using, say, this relation, which is p mu p mu is equal to m square. P mu p mu is equal to m square gives, expressing in this particular format, gives me e square is equal to p square plus m square. Now, as long as p mu is equal to m square, so this relation is satisfied by particles. These particles are said to be on shell, so they are physical, so they are supposed to be on shell. That means this relation is being validated by the particles. Why this is being stressed is there could be some very small time periods, so which is allowed by the uncertainty relation. So time periods allowed by the uncertainty relationship, the particles could be off shell. That means they need not be satisfying this particular relation. They could be, these are called virtual particles. They don't really, they are not on, they don't satisfy this relation. They can take any momenta they want. They can take any momenta irrespective of their, they don't really satisfy the energy momentum relationship. So they can really take any momentum scale they can, they want actually. Now, I understand why this could be an not a trivial issue to understand. But I'll tell you, I'll come to this part once, maybe in a couple of lectures or maybe a bit more. You'll understand the importance of these things. But these are all the setting ground for, you know, understanding interactions. Okay, so but this is the definition of virtual particle. There are scenarios in which these particles become say off shell in physics, and okay, Now, what does relativistic mechanics do? Relativistic mechanics, including quantum mechanics, we are putting relativistic mechanics in relation to. So, relativistic quantum mechanics allows people, particles to decay. Say, for example, you have neutron decays and pion decays and everything. Or the other one would be to convert one to another. That means if you have annihilations of electron positron annihilations, they as electrons get converted into say muons or any other higher energy particles like taus, BB bar, or top anti top if it has enough energy. And we want to understand right now which part is meaning how these processes are possible. And how does relativity play a role in this process actually? So we'll try to understand, say first, both these things, decays and cross sections, as we go along in a little bit more detail actually. So let's start a typical process, which we say, let's consider a decay. In a typical decay, there is a particle A, say for example, A. Which is decay into two decay remnants. So these are the two decay remnants. So this particle A just disappears, and then you have two decay remnants B and C. These are two other completely new particles. Example is say pion. So pion plus can decay into a muon plus and a neutrino, nu mu. Similarly, pion minus can go into a muon minus and a nu mu. Okay, now you see a new mu bar in that case. Okay, I had to put a bar here. Now this decays we have seen in the experiment, right? In the bubble chamber, in the first two lectures, we had these tracks of a pion coming in, and then this horizontal track, and then leaving into a muon, which is a virtual track. And here the neutrino doesn't leave a track because it's not charged. Now, suppose if I want to understand this particular process theoretically, so I have seen this process in experiment. So there are cosmic rays which are coming and hitting in my cloud chamber rather than bubble chamber actually. This is actually happens in a bubble chamber. Now I want to understand this process. So first of all, this process is a relativistic process, okay, because this particle could be at rest, say for a particle. I can imagine that the pion which is produced is sort of being at rest and then sort of decays into two particles. So if I want to write this amplitude, the amplitude contains two main parts which multiply each other. So the first part of this amplitude is so called the matrix element, which we'll start looking at once we learn a little bit more about the interactions and everything. So the first part is called M, or a curly M, or cursory M essentially, which is determined completely by the dynamics. So whether it could be weak interactions, strong interactions, or some other electromagnetic interactions or something. And then there is a kinematic factor which is independent of the dynamics. It doesn't really matter what is interaction which is responsible for this particular process, whether it's a decay or collision or cross section or something. This kinematic factor is called phase space. So this is independent of the interaction strength or whether the interaction is strong or weak or anything. So for example, in the example we have seen, pion going to mu plus and nu mu, the previous slide. So in this slide, we have seen pion going to mu plus nu minus. This decay is done through big interactions. Okay. So for example, it's done by weak interactions, or essentially it's some sort of an annihilation process in which there is a weak interaction. Whereas that information that this is a weak interaction enters in this M part. Okay, and the rest of the thing completely depend upon the point that this is just a relativistic process. So this is called the kinematic factor. Today we'll look in more in details about this kinematic factor, and later on we'll start moving into this dynamical factor. So what we are going to try today to is understand this kinematic factor actually. So let's say that this decay, I can see it in any frame of reference. Say for example, there could be many frames of reference. So one of the easiest frame of reference is the center of mass frame of reference. So in the center of mass frame of reference, the pion is sitting at rest, and B and C, say muon and neutrino, are decaying back to back from each other. So the pion is sitting really at the center, and so and the muon and the neutrino are going back to back. So that's how you see it at the center of mass. The lab frame would be completely different, because the lab frame is where we have seen the tracks. No, you have seen the tracks like this essentially. But if you go into the center of mass frame of the pion, you should see back to back. You're really sitting on the top or the rest frame of the pion actually. Anyway, the calculations become extremely easy in the rest frame of the pion or in the center of mass frame. So for example, if I take in irrespective of that, the four momenta is now considered instead of the individual momenta. So it's always the four momenta which is considered in relativistic systems. So PA, generally what we can write is PA is equal to PB, PC. All these are four momenta. All these three momenta written here are the four momenta. Now, in this particular case, PA, suppose if in the center of mass frame of reference, what happens? The particle A is sitting at rest, say, or in the rest frame of this particle A. In the rest frame of the particle A is sitting at rest. So its three momenta, so it's not moving. So its three momenta is set to zero. So its energy is completely is mc square essentially. So or m, okay, m. Its energy is nothing but the mass, rest mass of this particle, and it's there is no momentum for it. It's zero. So these two have momenta B and C. So their momenta, if you want to, coming from this equation, would just become opposite to each other. The three momenta are just opposite to each other. So and they're equal in magnitude, and they're just opposite to each other. This is what happens in a center of mass or a rest frame of mass. So this is an example of a decay in a rest frame of the particle actually. So similar thing happens in a center of mass frame actually. So but in a lab frame, this won't happen. So you need to consider, so each of them, say for example, the energy and the momentum of this particle A, energy and momentum of the particle B, and then energy and momentum particle C. But still, the relation that the four momenta is equal to the initial particle A is equivalent to the sum of the four momenta of PB and PC will always hold true actually. So will always hold true, and that has to be taken into consideration. Okay. So in a typical scattering particle, again you can the amplitude would be equivalent to, there is an equal to sign missing here. So there are two particles, say A and B, coming and hitting, and then giving you two particles C and D. Here also you can the amplitude of this particular process is given in terms of a part which is called the matrix element, which is dependent on the dynamics or the interaction strength, say whether it's a photon or a gluon or a W or a Z, which is being mediated here, and a part which is completely determined by its masses, momenta, and the relativistic kinematics. So that is called the phases. The phase space is not phase space. So the phase space only is essentially related to the kinematical factors of the thing, like what are the masses you are involved in, what are the momenta of these incoming particles, what are the momenta of the final state particles, and whether you have taken into consideration the relativistic energy momentum conservation or not. That's all. The phase space factor. The matrix element, on the other hand, worries whether this particle, you are worried about the spin interaction, if the spin is part, take part of the interaction or not, whether, okay, whether or how strong is the interaction, whether this interaction is mediated by W or a Z, or whether it's a neutral current process or a charge current process, or whether it's a strong process with a gluino, or whether it is a photon mediated process. All these questions will be answered in the matrix element. So in the center of mass frame of reference for this collision also, what we will have is PA plus PB is equal to 0. In that frame, so these two are always back to back from each other. So A and B will be coming and colliding back to coming here from here, coming like this, and this C and D will go off with an angle or something like this. They always will be, both the particles will be coming here and then going off in this particular direction. This part. So you will always have this relation PA plus PB is equal to PC plus PD. Okay, in this mass frame. Lab frame would be depending upon similar to what we have seen in the decay case. So it will be very much similar to. So this four energy momentum tensor will always be valid, but the condition is always that in the center of mass frame of reference, the sum of the three momenta of the incoming particles will always be zero. And if it's a 2-2-2 process, the final state also, it will always have the final 2-2-2 particles also, the sum of the momenta will, three momenta also will go to zero. This will be equal and opposite in direction. But this is not always true if it is, say, for in different frames. So we'll see some examples actually. Yeah. So this the other frames could be also there. So it's precisely it's what I'm saying. There could be other frames also. So for example, one of them could be completely stationary. Okay. So it need not be a collider. So in a collider, what happens? You have both the particles where along the beams, which have the same energy, same type of particles with the same energy going in opposite directions. So same particles, same energy going in opposite directions and coming and hitting. Okay. But there could be other experiments in which one of the targets could be completely stationary. So if these are called fixed target experiments. So in this case, what happens is B is a target particle which is stationary, like Rutherford scattering experiment. Okay, something similar. So this particle is completely stationary, it's not moving. Its momenta is actually zero. So PB bar is equal to zero. So again, it's at rest. But the incoming particle A is coming and hitting this particle B. Okay. Incoming particle A is coming and if you do the same, so this is the lab frame, say for example. In the lab frame, you have a particle B sitting at rest and a very incoming particle coming and hitting this particle. A is coming and hitting this particle with some momentum. But if you go into the center of mass frame of reference, both the particles are moving with equal and opposite directions or with speeds essentially. So with equal and opposite momenta and same magnitude, if you go into the center of mass frame of reference, okay, as long as the masses are very comparable to each other, okay, the masses are comparable, but and the momenta are much higher, or the momenta are much higher than the masses. So masses, yeah, could play a role, but let's imagine that because we are in relativistic case, the momenta could be much, much higher than the mass themselves. So the frame, in the previous case, the center mass frame and the lab frame or the fixed target frame, there could be any number of frames. There is a this is frame, this is called a fixed target target frame. Then there is the the A frame. So B could be a frame of its own. You can do the same analysis with A as the frame. So you can sit on the top of A, whereas B is moving towards A. So this kind of, this can be another frame. Okay. There could, okay, so there could be several frames, and from moving from one frame to another, you can do the calculations. But in some frames, things could be easy, like the center of mass frame of reference, the calculations are much easier. But in general, you can work in any frame you want, depending upon but the answers would be, this final results would be the same, but the calculations could be complicated in some other frames actually. So to move from one frame to another, so you typically do all the calculations in a frame which is very easy, like for example the center of mass frame of reference, and then move from one frame to another by applying a Lorentz transformation. So you apply a Lorentz transformation and that's it. So like I am saying that you have a collider, say for example, you typically take identical particles with almost identical energies, and then this is what happens in a collider, and then you hit them on each other. Say for example, this is how the colliders, the most famous colliders have been. The LEP collider at CERN, which was a precursor for Large Hadron Collider at CERN, had an electron and a positron collider hitting with each other, and the momenta they had, their energies were approximately 100 GeV per each beam. So each electron and positron were accelerated to energies of the order of 100 GeV. And now you can imagine that the mass of the electrons is MeV, essentially it's half an MeV. So the beam energy is GeV, it's about 1000 times larger, and it's 2000 times larger. So the so the electron has been accelerated about 2000 times larger than what its mass is. So these are highly relativistic. The same thing, Tevatron had something similar. So these are protons have a mass about 1 GeV. They have been increased to about a few TeV actually. They were about 2 TeV each. And these are proton-antiproton collisions at Tevatron. LHC, now proton about 1 GeV. Again, about 7000 times the initial original energy, the mass of the proton, 7000 times the mass of the proton. So from GeV to all the way up to TeV, and because proton is 1 GeV, and 7 TeV, so that is 7000 times more than the mass of the particle itself. So that's the speed with which they're moving. And so that's so you really gain that kind of an acceleration, you really give that kind of acceleration to the proton actually. Again, in any of these colliders, it's much, much easier to go into the beam axis in which the beams are traveling and they're colliding at along the beam axis. So you can always go to something called the center of mass frame of reference, and then in that case, PA, the beam A, and the beam PB will have this equal and opposite momenta. Anyway, in colliders, it's easier because they are identical particles and identical energies. So you'll simplify the calculations of this phase space much easier. But if you still want to work in one frame to another frame, say for example, then you have to apply Lorentz transformations. So what you do, you just take in one frame, say E1, P1. So this is P mu 1. Or P mu is a frame of this particular E1 and P bar. Maybe there should be a 1 here. But anyway, I think I have defined P prime. Okay, fine. There should be a P prime and E prime. So if you want to move to a different frame, which is say this could be the center mass frame of reference, this could be the lab frame, this could be anything else, okay, or the target frame or the attacker, anything. So if you want to move to another frame, which is a primed frame, okay, let me call it P mu prime, then you apply a Lorentz transformation determined by the beta, which tells you the difference of the energy or the velocities between these two. So what is the these two frames, say for example, unprimed frame and the primed frame, with the beta takes care of that difference. Whether you need to have, it depends upon whether it's on the same direction, moving in the same direction or in the opposite direction, whether it's at a certain angle, whether it's not at a certain angle, whether it whether it requires some rotation or something. All this information is contained in this capital lambda beta menu, and this is the unprimed basis. Okay, this could be any frame. Say the example I was trying to give was that the unprimed basis could be the center of mass frame of reference, whereas the primed basis could be the lab frame. So you move one to another frame by applying the Lorentz transformation. So now let's look at some examples of the conservation of the energy, applying conservation of energy, and see what are the implications. So let's again look at decays. These are simple decays which are very easy to deal with. Let's look at decays of pions. Pions come in three varieties, pi plus, pi minus, and then pi zero. Pi zero is the neutral pion, and pi plus, pi minus are the charged pions essentially. These are all pseudoscalar particles, that means they don't have any spin. They also violate, so under parity, they change sign. So these are pseudoscalar. Okay, so this masses of the pions are not very, they are all very close to one, so it's around 139, around between 135 and 140 MeV. So we'll just take it to be around that scale. Okay, the exact numbers you can find in PDG. So M pi is roughly 139 MeV, but we'll just write it. Okay, muon is a mass about 105 MeV. Neutrino is roughly massless, so you, it's an EV, so it's a million times smaller. Okay, it's a million times smaller than the mass of the any of these particles. Maybe even more than even much. So it's a billion times smaller than the mass of the muon. Actually, it's a billion times. You know, pion is now you can actually make them decay at rest. So this is possible that you can slow these pions down in laboratory. So you produce them in some sort of a fixed target experiment, and then goes through some sort of a slowing chamber in which they are almost non-relativistic. So they are not relativistic; they are moving very slowly, and then you can study their decays in much greater detail. So this is called pion decay at rest. So rough, this is not purely at rest, but it's almost as good as at rest essentially. So this this frame of at rest can actually be seen in a laboratory. You can organize it, you can organize that actually. So there is this happens in some, there are very experiments called LSND and various, these are fixed target experiments. So there is a fixed target, means again there is a beam, so there is a target which is made up of some, it could be ion or something, and there is a high energetic proton beam which is like a simulation of the cosmic rays. Okay, so you come and hit the beam, the beam which is highly high energetic protons comes and hits the ions and molecules of this particular target. It could be iron or anything, many things there could be, and then it produces a bunch of pions, kaons and all these debris. And now you can separate these particles and make them go through various directions, and in, and you can actually slow them down, and so you can make them actually sort of simulate conditions almost that they are almost at rest. Actually, this, so this rest frame can be organized in laboratory, but it's not always possible for every other particle. Okay, okay, it's not always possible for other particles. I will see examples actually. So let's take in the rest frame of the pion. Again, we apply the energy momentum conservation. P pi plus is equal to P nu plus and P nu mu. And so this gives you two relations if you expand this essentially, that E pi plus is equal to E mu plus E nu. So this is the energy of the muonic neutrino, the energy of the muon and the pi plus. And the three momentum again is equal to the other two momentum. We know that the pion is at rest, so P bar pi plus is equal to zero. So that, as we expected at rest, almost similar to the case of the center of mass frame of reference, the muon and the neutrino should go back to back. Now if you look at the energy part of this relation, so the so that one that fixes, so their magnitudes are same, they go in opposite directions. And the momentum part of the muon and neutrino are opposite in direction, and they're back, they should go back to back. Now if you look at the energy part, because it at rest, it's essentially just the rest mass of the particle, which is m pi plus. Now you know what is E mu, and from this part you know E mu plus is equal to E nu, neutrino mass is roughly m nu square plus p bar nu mu square. You can set the neutrino mass It's very small, it's a billion times smaller, so you can just set it to 0. And this is just the momentum of the neutrino. So you can write everything in terms of momentum of the neutrino and the muon mass. So you see that this is equivalent to momentum square of the neutrino mass square, neutrino momentum square plus square root of muon square mass square plus pion neutrino, the same thing, the neutrino momentum square, because they are equivalent to the muon momentum. Now, this tells you that m pi should always be greater than or equal to m mu. So, at the minimum, it should be at least be equivalent to the m mu. So, that's the relation it tells you. So, what it tells you that one of the conditions that for a particle to decay is that here I have set neutrino mass to be is equivalent to 0 because it's much easier. But you can argue the same thing with not putting neutrino mass to be non-zero. This tells you that the mass of the particle which is decaying should be at least greater than or equal to the sum of the masses of the decaying partners. So, this is very, I will tell you a story related to this, but this is very interesting. That means it tells you that if a particle A is decaying into a, if a pion is decaying to mu plus and mu mu, or if it is a particle A instead of a pion decaying into B and C, the mass of A should always be greater than or equal to B, mass of B and mass of C. This is the, as long as this is true, okay, otherwise this is true as long as these particles are at on shell, so they satisfy the energy momentum relationships. So, so the sum of the masses of the daughter particles. Now this is true for all physical particles. So all physical. So you cannot have anything decaying to something else whose mass. So for example, a muon cannot decay into a pion. That's not possible from purely relativistic mechanics. Dynamically, it may be possible. Dynamically, okay, the interactions can say okay, muon can decay into a pi plus. But the kinematics or the relativistic mechanics will not allow you such a decay to happen. Okay, say for example, electron cannot decay into a muon. Okay, so that's it. The electron is the lightest particle, so it cannot decay into anything. So similarly, there are many other examples. Like for example, I'll introduce more particles. I don't want to say kaon can decay into 2 pi's, but pion cannot decay into kaon. Kaon is much heavier in a heavier mass. Okay, it's around 200 MeV, say for example. Okay, so anything which is heavier in lighter in mass cannot decay into a particle which is heavier in mass. Now this looks extremely obvious and everything, but it's interesting in the sense that in relativistic mechanics, you know that you can convert one to another, but as long as the particles satisfy if they are all physical, meaning they are all on shell, this is possible. This constraint is still there. So you cannot produce, you cannot have a decay particles which are heavy coming from decays of lighter particles. You cannot have coming from decays of lighter particles. But this could happen the moment the particles are no longer on shell. That means, so this relationship which I have been saying, that this does a decay of particle can only decay into lighter particles as long as it is on shell. Now suppose if this is off shell, so suppose if it is in a collider or something, so this particle need not be on its on shell. This could be some sort of a virtual particle. Okay, like I said, this could be created for a very small period of time, and then it can decay into mu plus mu pi. This particle doesn't satisfy energy momentum relationship. It carries the momentum coming from here, so it can have much larger. It's not at rest. Okay, so its particle is sort of virtual, and so it can decay into higher and higher particles. Okay. So this is what happens in colliders, okay. But if a particle is on shell, this won't happen. So okay. That means if they are physical, it cannot decay into, say, for a electron, when it's physical, this cannot happen. Meaning this gamma cannot decay into a photons. Photon cannot decay into mu plus mu minus. Photon, when I say this photon is off shell, that means it's not really, you are not detecting this photon in the collider or something. It's not, we cannot exactly say what its momentum is and what is it, this thing is. It's not detected in the collider. Okay, we'll see this in more greater detail. So for the present, this is just a side remark. We'll keep seeing this in more greater detail. So let's take another example of a decay. In this case, pi 0. So pions typically decay into mu plus and nu mu, pi plus and pi minus go to mu minus and pi nu bar. What happens to pi 0? Pi 0 decays into two photons actually. Pi 0 is a neutral particle, but it still decays into photons. We'll come to it why. So pi decay at rest, say for example, we just take it to be at rest. So it has mass and zero momenta. So its four momentum just carries m pi and zero. And the two photons are massless. This is an error here. There is an e gamma, sorry. There is an e gamma here and there is an e gamma. So there is an typo here. There should be e gamma and p bar. And there is e gamma and p bar. And then what you can see is that the photons carry a momenta which is nothing but half of the pion mass when you get the four momenta. Okay, so e gamma will be essentially equivalent to photons are massless but they carry a energy. So this energy is equivalent to just the half of the mass of the pion. So in the rest frame of the pion mass, a photon decay, pion decay in the rest frame of the pion, pion decays into two photons, each carrying away half the mass of the pion. But this is actually a nice example where you can calculate. But like I said, you can really have some sort of laboratory situations in which you can have slow down the pion and you can do that. But Higgs also has a very, very similar decay. And this is how it was detected. The Higgs decays into two photons, so gamma 1 and gamma 2. So they are, we would expect in the center, when the Higgs is at rest, they go back to back, okay, in the center of mass frame of the frame of reference or in the rest frame of the Higgs, they go back to back. But in general, in the detector, the Higgs is produced and it's really moving very, very fast. It's not at rest at all, essentially. In fact, it's moving very, very fast. Sometimes it could be boosted also. That means, that will be covered in other courses. But anyway, so sometimes it is pretty fast. And so you have to consider all the four parts, essentially. So you cannot just say, here I wrote it correctly. You cannot just say that the Higgs doesn't have any momenta. So if you write the four momenta of the Higgs, you have to put in back the four momenta of the part of the Higgs and you have to consider the full energy of the Higgs which has the momentum part also. Similarly, E gamma 2, P bar E gamma 2 for the second photon and the first photon. And then we have this relation between the three particles. The Higgs four momenta is equivalent to the four momenta of the gamma and gamma 2, the sum of the four momenta of the gamma 1 and gamma 2. Now, what can we learn from this? So, you know, say for example, p square of the photon is equal to 0. Okay, you know that the p square of the photon is equal to 0. So, now but p mu of gamma 2 of the second photon can be equated to P of the Higgs minus the P gamma 1. Suppose in the collider, I know, say for example, the Higgs energy very well and the Higgs, one of the photons energy and momenta very well. Then I can use that to determine what happens for the all the angles essentially. So I don't need to know what happens to the second photons. The second photon I can just use the energy momentum relation and the point that p square of the second photon is equal to second photon is equal to zero, then I relate this, write this second part, this equation p mu is equal to zero, and then I expand the p mu in terms using the energy momentum conservation. So p Higgs minus p gamma 1, p Higgs into p gamma 1 minus, expand this bracket. So I get p mu of the Higgs, p mu of the gamma, and then there is a dot product between the p Higgs and the p gamma. Now the gamma p square is equal to 0, and p square of the Higgs is just nothing but the Higgs mass square. And so I end up having energy of the Higgs times energy of the gamma 1 and minus 2 p Higgs and 2 p gamma 1. So this gives me some sort of relation below, which I have written here. Okay, so there is this is one of the relations you can get, the relations which equates the Higgs mass to be equivalent to its energy, or the energy of the gamma 1 to be equivalent to. You can use this relation to fix the angle, say for example, what is the cos theta between the Higgs and the p gamma. Okay, what is the angle between the Higgs direction and the Higgs production direction and the angle of the photon which came out. So these are the kinematics. There are other kinematics which are called like for example invariant mass and so many on other things, which perhaps Jyotsna will cover in her experimental particle physics course. So this tells you that the energy momentum relationships, the four momentum can be used to constrain, say for example, this will determine what is cos theta. Cos theta is just given in terms of these particular observables actually. Okay, if you know the Higgs mass, if you know the Higgs energy and the Higgs, photon energy, you know what is cos theta, say for example, from this relation. So coming back to the point that I said that pion and Higgs are neutral particles, pi 0 and Higgs are neutral particles, they don't really couple to photons, because photons only see charged particles. Because if there is no electric charge, there is no electromagnetic interaction, so they don't see it. But this photon, pion and the Higgs couples to fermions. So that means they couple to quarks and leptons, which are essentially spin-half particles. So they go into some virtual process like this, and through virtual process, it couples to the photons. These could be the real photons, but this sort of a triangle in between is, which we'll see in which is some sort of a higher order process in perturbation theory. These interactions between the Higgs and the fermions are possible, and the pion and the fermions are possible, and so they go through some loop like this, and this loop gets connects to through this loop they connect to the photons, actually this through this like triangle problem. So this is a bit this diagram is called a Feynman diagram. We'll see this in these are called some sort of higher order process actually, but this is just for information. Okay, and we'll see the details of it maybe at some point actually. Again, coming back to collisions, now we have seen about decays now. So this is what I was saying, that so suppose if you have p1 and p2 in one frame and in the center of mass frame of reference, so this could be the Higgs decay, say, or say E plus E minus going to say mu plus mu minus or any of the other things. But in the lab frame, it could look, this entire process could look like something like this. P1 and P2, P2 could be completely stationary, and P3 and P4 would come in some particular angles. But still, in any frame, you can somewhat sort of, in that particular frame, you can write, in each frame, you can write P1 plus P2 is equal to P3 plus P4. So in each frame, you have this energy momentum conservation, and which you had to write it down. So if you want to move from one frame to another, so in the lab frame, using the velocity additional formula, so which is the new velocity, so after two successful Lorentz transformations, you'll have v1 plus v2 is equal to 1 plus v square. We have seen it in terms of addition of boost. Essentially, we wrote down the entire same thing. We get something like this, essentially v1 plus v2 plus v square. So in this particular example, say if p2 is stationary in the particular example, okay, if you want to move to the frame where say for example or if you want to move into the frame in which, so one of these frames, the velocity you had to apply would be say for example 2 times 1 plus v square. So this is the velocity you had applied to the one of the particles. It should be p2. Say for example in this frame, say for example p2 is stationary, but if you want to go into this center of mass frame of reference, you had to apply it accordingly. So here it should be okay, one of the velocities is 0, the other velocity is v1, so you had to apply a velocity which is v1 1 plus v square. In the other case, if we want to apply, say for example pt is also moving, suppose if p2 is also having a velocity v2, accordingly you have to apply this velocity additional formula to move into the center of mass frame of reference. Okay, in one case, if so depending upon the case at hand, if p2 is stationary or p2 is not stationary, you will have to apply the velocity additional formula accordingly. But instead of using this four momenta p mu is equal to four momenta, you can actually look for invariants. Okay, you can look for invariants which are sort of invariant under any frame of reference. So they are the same in every frame of reference. So one of the things which is invariant under any frame of reference is so-called this parameter p1 plus p2 whole square, and this is equivalent to p3 plus p4 a square in 2-to-2 process. So this process is a 2-to-2 process. You have two incoming particles and two outgoing particles. So in this process, there are two incoming momenta and two outgoing momenta. In this case, you look the invariants are so this relation holds. So but this one p1 plus p2 whole square is equal to p3 plus p square. Now what we want to do is derive the observables in lab frame. These parameters, these quantities are invariant in all frames. These are invariants in all frames actually. So we can use that and say something already already about the independent of a frame. So if you want to say something independent of the frame, so we can say that. Say I'll give one a particular example of this, okay, in a second. So in a typical 2-to-2 process, you can list all the possible invariants actually. So these are invariants which are called S, T and U. These invariants are called S to U process. So what is this 2-to-2 process? There are two incoming particles with momenta P1 and P2. Something happens in this blob, which is this yellow color blob, and then there are two outgoing particles, which is P3 and P4. So there are some interactions which are happening in this blob, okay? But just from the knowledge of P1 and P2 and P3 and P4, we can say that there are certain things which are invariant under this particular in any frame of reference as far as momenta and concerned, energy momenta are concerned. So one of them is the sum of the incoming moment, four momenta. S is P1 plus P2 whole square. The P1 and P2 are the sum of the incoming momenta of these two particles. These are the four momenta, by the way. This is all four momenta. If I say three momenta, I'll always put a bar. Then other invariant is P3 minus P1 whole square, which is P4 minus P2 whole square. And third one, these are also equivalent to P3 plus P4 whole square. And the third one is P4 minus P1 whole square or P3 minus P2 whole square. So remember, this S, T and U, these are kinematic variables. So these kinematic variables take the have units which are energy square. So these are all, S is contains energy square, T contains energy square and U contains energy square. So this STU are the same in every frame, whether it's center of mass, lab frame, any other frame, these are invariants because they are, the way they are constructed, they are always invariant because they have the same value in every frame. And this becomes extremely useful and handy. Let us take an example of, say for example, creation of particles. So let's somebody wants to build a collider, say for example, say they want to build an electron positron collider. So E minus and E plus, each with momenta P1 and P2. These are four momenta. P1 square is equal to me square, P2 square is equal to me square. So they are both same actually. And P3 and P4 are some X particles. They want to generate some X particles. And the mass of this X particles is mx square. Oh, there is a square missing here, by the way, P3 and P4 square. Okay. Now, just from the relation that P1 plus P2 whole square is equal to P3 plus P4 whole square, I can write S is equal to, if I expand this one, expanding this relationship, so is equal to 2mx square plus 2p3 mu p3 p4 mu. So this is the dot product actually between p3 4 momenta and p4 momenta. Now what does this tell you? So it tells you that if I want to create particles of mass mx, okay, so if I neglect the masses of this particle, electron masses to be almost close to zero because they are extremely light particles, their momenta should be at least in such a way that the momentum square, S is nothing but now roughly it will be just dependent, completely dependent upon the momenta, three momenta of these particles essentially. So their momenta, so if I just take P1 square, P3 square is equal to 0, and then you will have 2 P1 dot P2, that S is nothing but P1 dot P2, which is nothing but dominated by the momentum square of, it's essentially momentum square of the each of these electrons. So the momentum square of each of these electrons should be equivalent to at least the mass of the particle you want to, for each of this beam, okay, the mass of, they should be at least have enough momenta should be equivalent to the mass of this particle. So there is a constraint that if you want to produce mx square mass with a mass, say for example, say 100 GeV, say for example, okay, the mass of this particle is 100 GeV. So each of the electrons should contain mass at least of 100 GeV, so that you produce two of these 100 GeV particles through this E plus E minus collision essentially. So the electrons should be accelerated to momenta of around 100 GeV each, because I am neglecting the mass of the electrons, so that they can produce masses of the electrons of at least some particles of masses around 100 GeV. So each of these electrons should be now traveling at speeds about with energies about 100 GeV, and then you can create particles, two particles at least of this masses 100 GeV. So you can, so depending on the situation, you can put these constraints. So it is very useful to know what is the root S, or this S is the value of the momentum carried by this virtual particle S. Okay, this is the value of this. So this S sets you what is the energy momentum carried required, okay, by this particular case. And this is independent of any frame of reference or anything. You can just calculate it without worrying about which frame I am computing and how it is and everything. So in general, so these space arguments are very useful. Okay, so let me just introduce what is the general phase space arguments. Let's consider decays. So let there be a particle A which can decay into, we have been considering, say for example, two decay products. If you consider neutron decay, it has three decay products. Say neutron goes to proton, neutron goes to a proton, electron and antineutrino. So that's a three decay products essentially. Okay, so in general you can have m decay products. A particle can decay into m decay products, say for example, and then the four momentum energy momentum relation conservation gives you this kind of relation, where Ea is the initial state and Pe bar A is the final state, and the initial state energy is equivalent to E1 plus E2 is equal to Em, and Pa bar equivalent to 3 momentum is equal to sum of all the 3 momenta. These are the final state particles. Now the total momenta P1 bar, P2, now what we are looking at is this P1 bar, P2 bar, and so will be constrained, so what are the free momenta? So what are the free momenta? Say for example, each of them has 3 variables. P1, P2, P3, P4 would be each carrying 3 variables, which are essentially Px, Py, Pz and so on. So, okay, 1, 2, 3. So there will be M. So 3M. So 3M variables are there in the final state. Okay. And there are 4 constraints. One from the energy and one coming Px, Py, Pz. So there are 3 these are 3 relations, the second part, and the first part gives you 1 relation. So together there are 4 relations. So you have 3m minus 4 number of constraints, and Px, Py, Pz, these are the 3, are the 3 for each momentum. Okay, for each momentum you have. So the total number of constraints, free momenta you have is 3m minus 4. If there are n decay products, say for example, if there are 2 decay products, so 3m, 6 minus 4, there will be 2 momenta free, because x and y is already fixed, and so you will only have one angle. In the end, actually, it just becomes even more. In the rest frame of reference, if it is 2, it is none of them is constrained. There is no free variable, actually, as we will see. So in the rest frame, actually, this number actually becomes even smaller, and so that this relation is invalid for m is equal to 2. So if in the rest frame of the particle, okay, so it doesn't really depend upon where this orientation is. So okay, where the initial state Pa bar is, it's where this orientation is, this way, this way, this way, this way. So you can remove 3 more particles, 3 more constraints. You can include 3 more constraints. So 3m minus 4 minus 3. So 3 more variables get removed. So the total number of variables in the rest frame would be just 3m minus 7. So now you see that this is that if m is equal to 2, it's a highly over-constrained system, and it doesn't really, this number counting doesn't really matter. And if it's m is equal to 3, for example, then you will have 2 variables. There will be 2 momenta, say for example, which will be free. So 2 variables of the final state, which would be considered to be the sort of the energy of the electron, and it could be the angle actually. This would be 2 kinematic variables. So in 2 kinematic variables, you can completely do the calculation, fix everything. If you work in the rest frame of the particle, in general, okay, if you don't work in the rest frame, okay, it's a different matter altogether. So in general, the most general formula for a decay is given by this particular formula, where gamma is something called the decay width, is equivalent to 1 by tau. Tau is the lifetime. So 1 by tau is the lifetime. This is equivalent to 1 by twice the mass of the particle by 1 by some factors of 2 pi into some integral, which I will define just now, which comes out to be a function of the mass of the particle itself, mass of the ma. In this particular case, the example we are considering, it's mass of A, okay, the mass of the particle which is decaying, times some coefficient which is called matrix element square, which we have said, no, this is the This is the part which is determined by the dynamics. So we'll come to that later on in the next lectures, in the coming lectures. So let's say that this yellow shaded region is completely determined by the dynamics, what are the kind of interactions which you will be dealing with. Whereas Im square is nothing but the phase space factor, which is completely determined by the relativistic energy momentum conservation. So this integral for the decays is given in this particular format. So it's Im of m, which is the mass of the particle, is equal to some m decay products. So this is delta power 4 p minus sum over all pi. Pi are the daughter particle or the final state particles essentially. This integral is called the phase space integral. So this is the number of essential variables. So you have to do it in such a way, because you have to do this integral, it's a cubic integral and product of m particles. Okay, this is quite complicated. The best way is you actually write it in terms of some spherical polar coordinates and then look at variables which are constrained. So you remove all the variables which are putting back this delta, so you can solve this delta function, which is ends up, which are tells you what are the free variables and the limits on them. All these constraints will come into the picture. And this becomes quite complicated, say say for example, for m is equal to 4, if it is a 4 body decay, say A going to some 4 final states, this integral is quite complicated, and you have, even numerically it is quite complicated if you have to do it. It is not as easy as it looks like actually. So this sets you the phase space, it tells you. Now, if you do the same thing for collisions, say for example, let me say that A and B are coming, incoming particles, and there are some n final states. Now, in collisions, what happens in a typical collider is that for every event, say for example, for every collision, you may not be able to measure all the momenta and all the energies actually. It may not be possible actually. So, if all the momenta and energy are known, such a process is called an exclusive process in which everything is known. So, the initial state anyway you know, all the final state particles and their energies and momenta are very well known, that is called an exclusive process. And in some cases, say for example, some part of this collision process is not known. Say for example, some momenta may not be known, some momenta are missed, okay. So those are called inclusive process actually, okay. So you measure something, you measure the cross section, inclusive cross section, so in which some of this momenta may not be known, but there are methods of doing that. We will not worry about this in particular, this particular course. So, but I don't know, we will not come across inclusive because we will be mostly worried about computing other things. So, but this is just telling you how to do the calculation. So, most of the time we will only deal with exclusive momenta. We will not deal with this inclusive process, I think, most of the time. Yeah. So these are, so let's just say everything is known. So this is this gives the condition PA plus PB is equal to P1 plus P2 plus PN. So there are n final states, there are 4 momenta of n4 particles essentially. And so in terms of the 3 momenta of the 3 P1, P2, P3, P4, PN, P1 bar, P2 bar, P3 bar, PN bar. So you'll have, these are 4 conditions, and each of them will have 3 parameters. So 3N minus 4 essential variables will be there. Okay. So there are 3N minus 4 essential variables. Okay. There are certain comments here. You can neglect it. That is a bit, these two comments are related to something else actually. This will be a bit technical for now. Now you can write the cross section again in a formula in this particular fashion, in the most general formula. Mm-hmm. So again, the cross section is given by 1 by 2 root of some lambda is some function which I had written it here, given in terms of S, which is the S parameter, which is the sum of the initial state 4 momenta. square. So P1 plus PA plus PB whole square, then MS square and MB square, and then some pi factors and some integral given in terms of this invariant S essentially, and this matrix element, which is determined by dynamics, this matrix element, the curly M whole square essentially. And this integral, this is again the phase space integral, is given by IN of S is equal to some product of all this dp dq pi factors, okay, and with a 4 delta function, which is determined by pa plus pb some more I p4. These are four conditions, these are the four conditions, some more all the final state particles essentially. This also could be quite non-trivial, and typically this is done numerically most of the time actually. This lambda function written here is given in this particular fashion. This is S minus MA minus MB whole square minus 4 MA MB, MA square MB square, yeah. So this is the first cross sections you have been seeing. So to summarize, what we have seen today is that so to summarize, what we have seen is that just relativistic kinematics and relativistic four moment energy momentum tensor puts very strong constraints on already the kind of process one can are possible, and we have along the so for example, you say that particles which cannot be which are on shell cannot decay into particles which are heavier than themselves, like for, and if you want to produce also in particle creation, it tells you that it cannot produce something more. So this phase space puts really strong constraint. What are the possible process which can happen, and what are the possible purely from relativistic energy momentum conservation point of view. So this takes into consideration energy momentum conservation for a given particular process. So this is the first step in calculating any cross section or a decay width or something to understand various things. In the next lecture, we'll start looking at the first step towards how to compute this M square actually. Okay. So this is what we looked at. Something happened. Let's open this one again. So relativistic kinematics can fix quite a few things without the knowledge of interactions themselves. Okay, so then we will see other things which also put constraints, and then perhaps we'll go towards computing M square from the next lecture actually. Okay, thank you. Yeah.